We have 45 minutes in which I will engage in a conversation with Ratna, the author of this book, Daughter by Court Order. I'd like to first make a few comments on the book. I got it a few days ago, and the book instantly grabbed me, as we say. The title was interesting, Daughter by Court Order. What does that mean? I mean, obviously, you've got something to do with the court. But as I went through the book, I was totally engrossed and captivated in some sense by the book. As a women's rights activist myself and as a lawyer, because through the book I was very quickly able to recognize several situations that women find themselves in when they want to be their own person. You want to be someone who you think you are, and you find yourself in a number of situations. I use the word very mildly. You have to deal with, first of all, your parental home, where with all good intentions, your parents bring you up in a particular way. They don't bring you up as a child, they bring you up as a girl. So you learn certain things, you are molded in a particular way. You are, in subtle ways, you are told this is right, this is wrong, this is the way you do, this is the way you sit, this is the way you talk. There's a kind of guiding. There are in many homes elder brothers who take over the parents' role. When the daughter goes a little bit teenager, then the brothers come into the picture. There are married sisters, there are aunts. So you're dealing with all kinds of people in your own family. Then perhaps you get into your husband's home, and of course you have to work with your husband to see what he likes, approves of, doesn't approve of, what will make a happy marriage. How do you change your ways of being what you want to be to conform to certain things in order to have a happy marriage, get on with your in-laws, have a good marriage, and so on. And you also have to deal with society, which brings its own general rules, its own general restrictions into the picture. So these are all the various things that guide you. I don't say it's wrong, I don't say it's right. They mold you and they channelize you, and you have to confront these kind of situations when you want to be your own person, which means that you want to do something which perhaps is not in conformity. I'll ask a few questions later, but the story basically is about a domineering mother who disliked her girl child from day one. The child seemed to have been premature and was an incubator. The mother would have loved to strangle the child, and it was only because the child was born in Paris and there was a French nurse who seemed to have figured out the intentions of the mother that she kept a good watch over the child, and the child survived. And as the girl grows up, the mother uses every opportunity to tell her that she's worthless, she's useless, she was better born dead, she was better not to have been around, she's got nothing creative, and she belittles her in every way. And in the end, when this girl grows up and settles into her own family and so on, she tries to deprive her daughter of her inheritance. Now that sounds all too common, of course, that people are always trying to get you away from your inheritance. So she tries to deprive her daughter of her inheritance by denying that she is there, by denying her very existence, by not saying that such a daughter exists at all. And the inheritance is not small. This is a very wealthy, affluent family. The inheritance is large. They're politically well connected. The story talks about Nehru being at some wedding invitation, the grandfather is the chief minister of Madhya Pradesh. That's the background of the story. And the inheritance is so large that you think there's enough for everybody. But think Ambani Brothers and the public spat, and you will recognize that what Gandhi said was so true. There is enough for every man's need, but not enough for even one person's greed. And the daughter has to fight in the end for her inheritance. The novel is beautifully written in terms of language. The author, Ratna, is a master's in English from St. Stephen's College. Eventually, she did her economics from London School of Economics as well. She is the daughter of, she's as a writer, and I talk about her personally, she is the daughter of a well-known journalist. Her uncle is Arun Shauri, a well-known investigative journalist. So journalism or writing seems to run in the blood. And she writes very effortlessly, beautiful prose. There are very evocative descriptions of Delhi in a very wealthy family. I could not empathize, I could not figure that thing out, because I come from a very middle class family in Bombay where the flats are small and you're sort of juggling around. But this is, you know, large estate, and there are corridors and there are rooms and whatever. But it's written well. Delhi in the cold winter, Delhi in the summer, and so on. All this is there. The story moves smoothly. And in the course of the narrative, and this is what really sort of caught my attention in the end, in the course of the narrative, it raises a whole lot of issues about women's discrimination. Discrimination against women. Starting off with the girl child. Even in today's age, you still find that everybody or many people want a male child. That satisfies the family. I remember, I have three boys, so I'm no one to talk about not having a male child, but I remember that my maids and the neighbors and all said, you're very lucky, I wanted a girl at some point, but they said, don't worry, boys, you've got it, you know, that's it. So the male child is wanted all the time, and not just male child, but boys get to do what they want, girls don't get to do what they want, girls are guided, girls are told, this is not good, this is not right, choose a career that suits you, what are you going to do if you want to become a pilot, who will marry you, things like that, you know. So there's a discrimination against the girl child. Then this book has brings out violence in the home very, very vividly. The violence in the home, surprisingly, you normally think of the males beating up the women. I mean, that's what we sort of hear mostly, that women suffer at the hands of the male members of the family. And here you have a mother who is immensely cruel to the daughter. And I want to ask Ratna whether she thinks these things really happen. Because there is this mother, apart from the physical abuse, throwing her daughter against the wall, slapping her, you know, making her wear old clothes, stone clothes, and so on. There's also the constant verbal abuse. And that verbal abuse humiliates the girl, and it's described very beautifully about how the girl is practically shrinking into herself, hiding behind sofa sets and corridors, till her mother will say, come out from there, what are you doing there? And, you know, humiliate her all over again. So that kind of abuse in the family, which is a place where you feel safe, you're supposed to feel safe, you're supposed to get to blossom, to grow, to get to fulfill yourself. This is the place where in the story this child is abused by her own mother, and of course everyone takes the cue. If your mother's going to abuse you, what's the harm in somebody else piling on? And so this happens. The women in the story, incidentally, seem to be very strong women. The males are a bit more the weaker. The women are running the show in the story. As the child grows up into a young woman, what happens is a very complicated kind of character, the main character, Aranya. She is humiliated, she is defensive, she is afraid of many things, and yet somewhere there is a core of steel in her. And she becomes, she emerges as rebellious. She emerges as somebody who doesn't want to conform. And so she gets even more abused, because they say, look at others, how they behave, and you don't behave that way. So this is what you sometimes see in society, where you sometimes find, in a classroom, you find a boy who's very rebellious, throwing things and so on. Basically, sometimes they're shy. They've suffered somewhere and they take it out in another manner by becoming extremely macho or becoming very strong and, you know, doing things which are very, very hurtful maybe sometimes as well. If this was not the end of all the misfortunes, this young woman who marries finds herself all of a sudden deserted by her husband, and she is a single woman, a single mother, and she has to bring up the two children on her own. Her husband simply walks out on her one day. Now, why that happens, you can figure out, you can imagine. Either it is this woman's confidence is not good, she's not able to run a successful marriage, she's not able to balance the career and the home and so on, or maybe just plain bad luck, the man walks out on her. But she decides to bring up her children, her two children, her one, the youngest one, very small when the husband leaves her. She pays up a mortgage, brings them up, and so on. And society never sympathizes with such women. No society, in society, nobody will say, look at that woman, my God, she's brought those children up. Instead, you will always have, look at her, got rid of her husband. Something she must have done. So society never appreciates that you are struggling to do things on your own. Society wants the picture, hum do hamare do. They want that picture. That is a TV image of an ideal and a good family. And if you don't conform to that, then even society abuses you, even though you are doing your best under the circumstances to manage in society. What is amazing is that all these situations that I have told you, and these are the main women's issues which are confronting us today, are skillfully woven into a story and into a remarkable story where you want to turn the pages and go on until the end, which, as the book indicates, in the end, this young woman has to choose to fight for her place in the family, to fight for the fact that she's a daughter of that family by going to the only institute which is the last refuge of everyone. When all the negotiations fail, when everything fails, finally you say, I will go to court on this. And eventually, she does get her rightful place through a court order. So that's, in a kind of nutshell, the reason why this book is fiction, but raising important issues which make you stop all the while to think, does this happen? Is this a story? Is this fairy tale? Or is this something very, very real? So, I will ask Ratna some questions, and I hope, you would like to ask some questions also. We could allow that as well in the course of time. I am not a pro at this kind of a thing. I'm usually very comfortable in a court where I know how to deal with my legal opponents, but she's not my opponent here. So I will have to be rather nice to her also. So the normal question that you would ask a novelist, and that to a first-time novelist, because this is her first story, the normal question would be, why did you choose to write a novel? But I want to add a few more questions to this question. It seems to me that in this novel, it is so intense. It seems to me that you have dug deep into some experiences. I don't know if they are your personal experiences or the experiences of somebody you know well, but this does not look like it's come out of the top of your head, like a J.K. Rowling story, Harry Potter and the stuff, that's from your head, I mean, you imagine. Somehow it seems to me that it has come from deep within you. And I want to ask you, well, you may choose not to reply also, whether there are some, is the story the result of some personal experiences that you are familiar with, or which you have decided to put into fiction in this particular book. So why did you write the book, and how did you get these experiences which are so vividly described in this book?
Thank you very much. It's an honor to be here. Thank you very much. It's an honor to be here and a warm welcome to all of you here. And thank you very much, Norma, for that wonderful introduction. Writing a book and writing from the heart is always difficult. I am a first-time writer and this is my debut piece of work. And I'm absolutely thrilled and delighted with the response I've got. Coming to your question about how much of me is in those pages. Well, it is my style. It is the way I write. The quotes are my favorite quotes. The songs that I refer to are songs that I hear very often, for sure. I have two children. They have been an inspiration for me, for my work too. They're extremely critical about my work, just like most children are of their parents. I did grow up in Delhi. So Delhi through the seasons is something that I have watched and seen. I have, as I say in the book, seen India stumble and march from telegrams to Twitter, from black and white photographs and sepia photographs to Facebook and Instagram. And within that context and framework, I have set my story. It is a story which is unique. The times that we live in are unique because had this story been written 20 years ago, it would not have been accepted. Many of you may not have been even here to hear me speak. I may not have been on India's top 10, as I have, the book may not have made it there. The reason being that we all associated mother figures with Nargis, by, you know, Mother India, giving, forgiving, sacrificing, sweating it out for her kids. We also, most of us would remember Amitabh Bachchan's famous dialogue, "Mere paas maa hai, tumhare paas kya hai," kind of thing, right? But the times have changed. I have taken a culturally sensitive topic, something which is a kind of taboo in our society even today, and turned it on its head. My characters are very nuanced, they are very real, they have shades of black and grey and whatever comes in between. The stories that I tell are something that we see in our society. We choose to ignore it, but we do see it. In polite society, female infanticide does happen. In families that we would be totally surprised about. Families that grace your newspaper maybe every morning. That women, our daughters, are treated differently as a fact of life. I love to say that the shades of India differ. You know, the shades, whether it is a very dark and deep shade in which the daughter is in color, or a light passing over. But some of what I write, women do relate to, daughters do relate to, parents I hope relate to. Because the echo that we set off carries on for generations. It's not good to say this is my favorite child and this is not. So in my book, the favorite child actually loses his identity and sits on the veranda forever. It is the abused daughter who then finally finds her voice, and my readers rejoice in her victory when Aranya stands in court and holds her head up high and walks out looking up at the sun, which I've used as a metaphor, and it's shining and it's buttercup yellow, shining down on her and smiling at her victory. She hopes that she sees her grandfather smiling down at her. So I have taken things which are different, I've written them differently. I've also looked at the much maligned legal system. You know, every family, I've worked in the corporate world, so let me talk about that experience. I've come across people fighting long, protracted legal battles. They say it goes on for generations, especially civil cases. But in this case, but in my book, Aranya wins, gets her rightful share, and moves on in life. So the judicial system does work. It does. It is a law, maybe the last recourse, but if done with a firm head on your shoulder, it can work out. To sum it up, I think my book is a book of hope and courage. It is about believing in yourself. It is about taking that first step. If you did that, and you keep saying, what if? What if I go down that road? What if I don't? And a lot of us come across situations like that. we never managed to take that first step, and before we realize it, the goalpost has shifted. So that's what my book is about.
You said that 20 years ago, a book like this would not have been written.
May not have been accepted. Writing has been going on for ages and may not have been accepted widely.
So do you think, I mean, you've chosen the theme of a mother abusing a daughter, which is extremely unusual. Is that a 1% thing in society? What do you feel? Because you are turning our entire picture of society, where we believe that there are largely happy families, and even if there are unhappy families, it's a mother who always protects her children. Now, would you say your story is about a 1% which doesn't work that way, or do you think mother abusing daughter or child is more common? And this is a social issue I'm asking for.
Let me just share some data before I get into that. The Census of India showed 962 girls for every 1,000 boys. As the child sex ratio, by 1991, it had dropped to 945. Further down to 927 in 2001, and an astonishing low of 914 in 2011. A drop of 48 girls for every 1,000 boys 30 years. And here comes the truly shameful part. It is not the poorest and the least literate areas and communities that are killing off their infant girls. In fact, often the reverse is true. Let's look at what's been happening in Delhi. Apparently, a girl from South Delhi College, from a decent family, honorable family, chose to marry against her parents' wishes and was done away with. And the reports say that the mother was part of this whole thing. So what I want to say is that it is a hidden, silent fact, and silence by violence is an accepted tradition in our society. We tell our girls, don't tell. Izzat kharab ho jayegi. Mothers tell them, then the mothers in law tell them. So who's giving the boundary? Boundaries have been drawn up by women. I have taken a story which is powerful, and I've written about it because a lot of people come up to me and talk to me, women, and they're not surprised by what I write, and in fact share their own stories. I get invited to states and cities where I'm surprised by the fact that they want to discuss my book, because I thought these cities were affluent, forward-looking, these families were different, and yet they want to talk because they're using my book as a metaphor. They don't want to spoil their Izzat. So they say, what happens with Aranya, even we have seen. So the book is becoming a metaphor for people to discuss.
So do you think women are their own worst enemy, as they say? Do you think that is true? I mean, the abusive mother, there's one thing in your book where you don't get into why the mother becomes like this. Was she a victim of abuse also? You talk about it a little bit, but generally speaking, I what I'm saying is, does this happen because the perpetrator of the violence was also a victim of violence once? Is this a kind of circle which is going around? What do you think?
I'm going to answer that in 2 points. Firstly, I think it's a book about courage and hope, and about the daughter breaking the stereotype and standing up and believing in herself. I think one of the lines that, you know, when you write, you can pause to read what you've written, at least I do, and that was a defining moment, is when Aranya holds her child and tells her daughter that my story will not be yours. And that to me is a defining change. Coming back to, does it happen? Are women their worst enemies? I think daughters are their best hope. You know, I would put it like that. The broad shoulders are not outside. The hope and courage is within yourself. So you be the change. For your life, you change the script and that of your children. So change today, change now. Change with the book. Change as we speak. Reflect on it. And do it in little bits. So I think that is what I would like to see. to say. And
does the cycle go on and on? I mean, how does this thing break?
The cycle breaks with each one of us. And the fact about the mother, whether she was abused, whether she was whatever, violence, etc. No, it doesn't happen. In this book, the mother was a loved daughter, a loved sister, doted upon, mother of her son. So there was no abuse. Her father, in fact, was giving her flats and giving her cars and, whatever. She had a wealthy, powerful father-in-law and a pliant husband. So there was no opposition, there was no abuse. And yet this happened.
As a matter of fact, you draw the patriarch in a very good image. He is the patriarch of the family, the grandfather of this Aranya, who was CM of a place and so on, and very politically connected. He is drawn out, his character is drawn out as being very broad-minded, encouraging, welcoming this young granddaughter and so on. Much more than the women in the family who are sort of cribbing with each other and pulling each other down, so to speak.
Very interesting observation. What happens with Ishwarbhari, the patriarch, is that yes, he's wealthy, he's powerful, he's well connected. In fact, I think I also say in the first chapter that he was Nehru's friend. So I built him up like that for sure. And so we have the Kharis and we have the Sharmas. The Sharmas are from Punjab. They portray themselves and project themselves as being forward-looking, as being in with it, educated, erudite, and they look down on the Dharis, saying you're from Ranchi and therefore you're not progressive, you're feudal, and they leave no opportunity to bring out that contrast. However, life surprises us. So the person who was the patriarch and the custodian, so as to say, of a feudal patriarchal values, actually surprises us by being forward-looking. Not only with his granddaughter Aranya, but also by giving property in a time unheard of to his daughters, and thereby inking a different life for his granddaughter and other generations. And this is what I mean, that the echo that we set off resounds much after we have gone away.
Yeah. Okay, let's go to another thing. You talk about the courtroom scenes and so on, and one sentence struck me quite a bit. There is this girl's lawyer, and he's talking about your cases coming up and so on. There are two sentences actually. Once the lawyer tells her that the judge is a good man, like we got hope, the judge is a good man. And there's another time he says, "Jungle ka mamla hai, kuch bhi ho sakta hai." You know, so as a lawyer, I must tell you that in courts, we ourselves say, when talking about casinos and so on, we always say, why do the people object to casinos? Courts are the biggest gambling den. You enter in and you don't know what you'll get. You have no idea. You gotta have a good lawyer, you gotta have a good judge, you gotta have a good topic, the judge's background should be something which favors your point. If he favors industry, then if you're in environment, you're dead. If he favors corporate, then you're dead. If he favors labor, and then you're coming the other side. You can practically see it sometimes. So this struck me quite a bit. And considering that in Goa, many people do go to court because they, people go with so much hope, and they come to you and they come with the law and they say, "Madam, this, I've got a good case. I've got a good case." That's what is said all the time. And then you don't know, you want to tell them all this, but how do you tell them that, I don't know, the judge thinks that property is something this way, whether the judge thinks that way. So what would you, what would you say? Do you feel that would you encourage people to go to court, or would you say it was a horrid experience and you wouldn't want to go? What would you say to people?
I would say jungle ka mamla hai, kuch bhi ho sakta hai. Okay? The thing is that if you look at my book, Aranya was written off by her family, by society, by everyone. Right? And definitely she came late into the case, and she was up against the worst nightmare. Powerful parents, rich, politically connected, confident of subverting whatever, influencing whatever happens outside the judge's room and everything else. So Jangal ka maanga hai, she won, right? And sometimes life surprises you. It is your own confidence, your own belief, and the fact that you believe that you will win. And you will go about it without emotion. The one thing I know about courts, very little compared to your experience, ma'am, is the fact that you have to use your practical good sense. There is no emotion. The court will judge this way or the other. There is no emotion in this, or very little in any case. Everyone believes they have a good case, but present it in that way. Everyone has a good story. Write it and put it out there in a right way.
But I can assure you, you need a little bit of luck. At some point, you need some luck. Okay, there's not much time left. I wanted to ask you about what is needed to improve the status of women in our study, but there won't be time for that. But let me get you something. Your book is going to be made into a film soon. This must be very thrilling for a first-time writer. Let me ask you, and this is for any budding writers who might be out here, did you expect this kind of reception to your book? And what advice would you have for writers? Any tips that you have? How did you go about it? Or what made you go into this thing? What would you, just to wrap up this?
I'm delighted. I'm very grateful to each one of you and to my readers. I'm very humbled by how well my book is done. Thank you very much for your kind words and to all of you. As a first-time writer, I was told that you're writing it, kahin nahi jayega. It's not going to do much. You won't get a publisher. And I did. I struck it with it. So I would send out manuscripts and not hear back. And I kept J.K. Rowling, who you referred to, as my goalpost. She got 21 rejections. So I was still counting when I sold my movie script first. You know? And that was a great high. I had now someone who was interested in the movie rights and took them. I still kept counting and then I lucked out. I got Fingerprint as my publisher. And they are also India's largest distributors. So that made sense given the context of my book. After which, I also, you know, when it doesn't rain, it pours. So I got more offers after that, but I stuck with the one I had signed off with. I have to say, believe in yourself. Because my book did get published. They told me that no one, you know, new authors in English, no one really reads them till you get established. But let me tell you, I felt really good because I was on India's Top 10. I have been on India's Top 10 for 4 months. Book came out end of May. And I saw actually J.K. Rowling below me. And that was such a big high. I was like, oh my God, I can't believe it. So I took a screenshot and I made everyone take a screenshot. But that's for my grandchildren to see at someday. New York Times has featured my article. So, you know, believe in yourself. It's painful to write. The days when your brain really works hard and you can churn it out, and the days when it just doesn't cooperate, you know? And you have a story and then you get distracted, you put many sub-stories into it, so you can be focused, you can get it out there. And then there's a bit of luck, I guess.
You always need that little bit of luck, which I think what she's trying to say is, believe in yourself is the main theme of what she has. From a corporate world, she's become a successful writer. Maybe she will become a successful actress. Maybe she will move into the film world. But really good luck to you, Ratna. Do you have plans for a second book down the road?
Yes, I'm working on my second book for sure, and I hope to have it out there next year.
Okay. So I think I.
Questions.
Okay, I'm sorry.
A question. Hello Ratna. My question for you is like, is writing is also Jangal ka maamla? Publishing is also like Jangal ka maamla, or there is still more hope than the court rooms compared to like publishing and writing?
Okay, I'll speak from my heart. Jangal ka maamla subject.
Okay.
You can be the king of the game. By if it's a court case, I think being on top of it. You know, you may be just another case number for a lawyer, a very busy lawyer. So you have to be on top of what you're doing and know your facts and present it. And the lawyer has to relate to you as a human being. Strike up a friendship, maybe. Same with publishing, I guess. I mean, now Fingerprints is really my they're really good friends, and there are other publishers who are interested in my next book. Having said that, I think the thing is that writing is not jungle come up. That has to be focused, you have to have a style, you have to have a new idea and a narrative that clicks. So that is all up to you.
Questions? Any other questions?
My question is to you, do you think Ms. Norma Alvares said that the theme is extremely unusual? Do you think the theme is actually extremely unusual?
No, I don't. As I said, I've seen it, people have talked to me. I've grown up in India, I've gone to school and college, I've heard murmurings and mushrooms. And I have an extremely difficult relationship with my own mother. So, you know, these things happen. How many of us can say that it is a Hindi movie and everything is fine? Life is tough. And as I said, the shades can vary. It can be extremely difficult or extremely nice or somewhere in between. And I can't think of any girl who could stand up or a teenager and said, I've never had a disagreement with my mother. And that's true for me. I have a teenage daughter. My daughter is 16 years old. And I don't think she's going to grow up and say that, you know, I never disagreed with my mother. That's not possible. I have a son who's going to be 14. And of course we have our ups and downs because, you know, my heart walks outside my body now. I have two little children and I'm concerned, and I think I have a perspective which is a little wider based on experience. And so we agree, we disagree, we're great friends. And that's life. Thank you. On daughterbycourtorder.com, and please do take a look. Also, my website for my book has written down the laws under which women can be empowered. You know, so that's the first starting point. You should know who you are, what rights you have, and that the government and the constitution puts you on an equal footing as your brother or another male member.
Yeah, thank you, Ratna, very much. I think the important thing that we get from this book and this conversation we've had is that we have to start talking about these things. The more you talk about these things, you find that they're not so unusual, you're not so ashamed of it, that it happened only to you, not happened to somebody else, and so on. And if we have more and more discussions, or we speak these things out and don't hush them up, then I think we would find answers to how we can avoid this kind of violence in the home. Violence not just physical, but mental, it's even worse. And not feel threatened and be able to grow up into whatever we want to be. Whatever career, whatever life, whatever ideas we have, we should be able to eventually reach that without feeling stymied at every point by society, parents, family, etc.